Hi all, this is Aditya and welcome back to the Floating School. Today I would be talking about strategies of economic development. I have divided this lesson into two parts as usual. In the first part, I'll be talking about balanced and unbalanced growth strategy. Once we have discussed these two strategies, we'll move on to the second part where I'll discuss a really important question. Which growth strategy did India adopt post-independence? Out of these two strategies, balanced and unbalanced, which one did we adopt? And then we'll do an analysis of our decision. We'll try to identify the challenges that we faced, and if possible, we'll try to come up with some solutions. So let us start with balanced growth strategy. The proponents of this strategy state that all the sectors of the economy are interlinked, hence they should grow simultaneously. If they do not grow simultaneously, then over a long period of time, the overall economic growth of the country would be hampered. Let me give you an example. Suppose there are four industries: industry A, industry B, industry C, and industry D. And all of them employ a certain number of laborers. These figures are hypothetical, no significance at all. So suppose industry A employs 1 lakh number of laborers, industry B 1,20,000, industry C and D 1,30,000 each, and all of them must be producing some output. So suppose all of them are producing, industry A produces A units of output, industry B produces B units, C C units, and D D units. Now what happens? The government invests in all these industries simultaneously. The government, say, invests 500 crore rupees in all of these, each industries, 500 crores simultaneously. What will happen is that the incomes of the laborers in these industries will go up. How? Because if the government is investing money in a particular industry, that industry will grow, production would go up, and automatically the disposable income of the laborers working in that industry would go up automatically, right? Then what will happen, that since their disposable income has gone up, they'll start buying and selling each other's products. So the workers of industry A will start buying the products made by industry B, C, D, and workers of industry B will start buying the products made by A, C, D, and so on. So what is happening? Since all of them have money now, all the outputs of each of these industries are getting purchased and sold. So what happens? This simultaneous investments create demand for goods produced by one another, and the production will increase. Thus, the expansion of one industry helps in the expansion of others, and there is overall growth. Beautiful, right? The concept is really good and it seems logical as well. Now let me give you some real life examples. So this strategy states that all the sectors of the economy should grow simultaneously because all are interrelated. So let me give you some examples of interrelated industries. If you look at Indian cotton textile industry, it is heavily dependent on agriculture, cotton farming. If we don't cultivate cotton textile industry cannot develop, right? If we look into sugar industry, it is heavily dependent on sugarcane cultivation. Again, sugar industry is dependent on agriculture. We can't even import sugarcane because it is a bulk item. So if we want to develop sugar industry, we have to promote sugarcane cultivation. Now let me give you one more example. If you look at Indian FMCG industry, let me quickly tell you what is FMCG. See, consumer goods industry can be divided into durable goods and non-durable goods. When you look into durable goods, the examples are automobiles, furniture, electronics, small toys, tools. When we talk about non-durable goods, we mean FMCG. What is FMCG? Fast moving consumer goods. This industry produces non-durable goods like shampoo, toothpaste, soap, biscuits, etc., which are consumed within a short period of time. So Indian FMCG industry is heavily dependent on rural India. If the demand in rural India is not good, this industry suffers. And the rural India, the purchasing power of rural India is heavily dependent on agriculture sector, which means Indian FMCG industry is dependent on agriculture sector. So this is true that all the sectors of the economy are indeed interrelated. Now let us quickly jump into unbalanced growth strategy. Now first of all, I would like to state one thing, that the proponents of this growth strategy, unbalanced growth strategy, do not deny the fact that all the sectors of the economy are interrelated. They say, yes, we agree with you that all the sectors of the economy are interrelated, and they really agree with this beautiful picture, beautiful concept, that yes, if you invest simultaneously in all the industries, all of them will grow, there will be exchange between them and all of them would be growing. But they ask a question: do we have sufficient capital? Does the government has enough capital to invest in all these industries simultaneously? Do we have that much of money? See, underdeveloped countries are capital deficient countries too, right? So the proponents of this strategy say that if we invest small amount of capital in several sectors, none of them will grow, none of them will develop. So we should prioritize, we should develop few sectors first and then other sectors will follow. So in a way, you could say that a strategy of judicially planned unbalanced growth. This is a strategy of judicially planned unbalanced growth. Now let me give you a couple of examples. Indian Railways has over 300 pending projects. What happens every year after the budget, some money is allocated to all these 300 projects, say 1 crore to one project, 50 crore to another project, 30 crore to another project, and the work starts again. And once the funds are over, again the work stops. So can you imagine what is the level of capital deficiency? I was reading an article and I came across this really important, interesting fact that Indian Railways needs over 4 lakh crore rupees to complete all the 300 pending projects. Can you believe this? So if we invest small amount of capital in 300 projects, none of them will develop, right? All of them would take a substantial amount of time. So let me give you one more example. If you look at the irrigation projects in India, we have around 500 pending irrigation projects in India. So it is true that we need capital and we are a capital deficient country. Now let us move to this question. We looked into the balanced growth strategy, we looked into the unbalanced growth strategy, but I want to discuss this question with you: which strategy did India adopt post independence? Which strategy do you believe we adopted? Did we adopt balanced growth strategy or unbalanced growth strategy? Well, if you want to know the answer, you'll have to watch the second session. I don't want to discuss each and everything today itself. The second session would be a bit more interesting because we'll look into the strategy, we'll analyze our decision, we'll look into the challenges that we faced, and we'll try to come up with some solutions. I hope this helped you. If you like the video, give it a thumbs up. If you didn't like it, give it a thumbs down, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel. I would also request you to visit my website. It's www.thefloatingschool.com. I do have another website, www.theastuteinvestor.in. Thank you so much for coming today. Thank you so much for joining us. See you next time.